what happens now?
And if you should survive to 105, think of all you'll derive out of being alive. And here is the best part, you've had a head start. If you are among the very young at heart.
Good evening, everyone. Well, I know who my audience is, because I know you are all young at heart. Yes? Raise your hand if you're young at heart. There you go. Didn't you love just tuning in and hearing that music? I have to tell you, listening to the first song was really cool. They can't take that away from me. That song has a special place in my life. And then listening to Good Morning, my body went into shock just remembering all the choreography and the how energetic that was, and running up and down the set and then jumping on a couch and flipping it over and all of that. It was just, my whole body was like, remember? And you know, as we move into this whole understanding of ageism, I thought to myself, wow, I wonder if I could do that now. And my mind was like, yeah, with oxygen in each side of the wings, like Ann Miller used to have. But then I thought, why couldn't I do that now? Isn't that just me buying into a mindset, a race consciousness that as you get older, you lose certain things, you can't do this, you can't do that? Yet Jack LaLanne at 92 swam and dragged a boat behind him. So, you know, he didn't believe it. And a lot of people don't believe that stuff and defy the odds, you know, the odds, whatever the odds are. So welcome to our evening tonight. Hold on a second. I want to pull down the slide so that you can see each other. Can you all see each other now? There you go. Excellent. And people will keep logging in. Karen told me that when we were doing this the last time, about 68 people logged in the first 15 minutes. So speaking of Karen Oxweiter, Dr. Karen Oxweiter, here she comes. So tonight we're going to talk about ageism. Aging in a world of ageist ethics. Now, you don't need to age in a world of ageism ethics if you're willing to ignore what's going on. But tonight I want to talk about where the rubber hits the road and what's really going on in people's minds and, you know, where you sit with this. But tonight, unlike most of my Let's Talks, I have a little bit of a PowerPoint to start with to show you. Joe, I'm going to mute you until I need you, just so that you don't echo. Yes, Joe is our guest. She will have her moment in the sun shortly. But I want to start with, I need to start with this. Here we go. There you go. Let's start with just a definition. Can you all see that definition now? Great. Ageism, prejudice or discrimination on the grounds of a person's age. And I picked this gentleman's face because I want you to look at his face and I want you to just, what's your first impression? What do you think when you look at this? When you see this man's face, do you think old? It's hard not to see that and think old. Do you think viable? Do you think important? What do you think when you see this person's face? Do you think homeless? What do you think? That's whatever you thought. That is how your AEPs and your belief system and your dropping into race consciousness has brought you to that decision. Because frankly, there's another thing to look at in this face. Wise, lived, a face that has been lived in. Someone who has experienced so much. And he also has that, to me, he has that attitude of like, I just don't care about all the little stuff anymore. I'm way beyond all of that. And there was a time in our history where we looked upon this type of a face with such high respect. The greatest respect, the most important respect that they had value to give us in the world. So that's number one. Now I want to give you a couple of quotes. This is by Plato. It is for the older to rule, the younger to submit. Back in Plato's days, it's basically what they believed. The older, the wiser, that who has evolved, get to rule. That's where we find the richness. And the younger, I'm not crazy about the word submit, to be honest, although I still think of myself as the younger, although he was probably talking about me, because their age expectancy back then was about where I am. The younger to submit. But what that means to me is, would we not benefit from living in a world where we surrendered to the wisdom and the knowing of those that have gone before us? And then my last quote is this. Aging is an extraordinary process where you become the person you always were. David Bowie. Now just think about that. An extraordinary process where you become the person you already were. Okay, to me, what that means is becoming the person I always already was is, for me, saying to myself, and I don't know David Bowie, but I imagine this is what he meant, that I've always been this. I've always known everything. But as I go through the years, you know that little story of the little two-year-old that leans into the crib of his little brother, baby brother who's just born, and said, "You got to remind me, I'm starting to forget who we are." So we have all this forgetting in our process of living. And then we get older and it's like, oh my God, I knew this all along. Why didn't I act on it? Why didn't I act from it? All the things that I knew when they weren't working, people's illnesses. I believe that when we get ill, when we get sick, when anything goes on in our world of health, it's just our bodies waking us up and saying, what questions aren't you asking? And what answers aren't you listening to? And where do you need to change your life? What is it you need to do here? Know that you already do know. So I don't think we have to grow into old age by getting older and weaker. And somebody said to me the other day, they was like, don't you notice that every year you lose something else? And my head wanted to explode. I was like, no, I don't notice that. And the person was like, yes, you do. I was like, no. And then I got honest. I went, all right, yeah, you know what? There are moments when I actually think to myself, God, I used to do this much easier. But I'm stopping that. Even today, I went to sit down in a chair, and I'm a little tight from I've had a very busy weekend. And I literally stopped myself from going, ugh. I did. I consciously said, you will not make a noise when you sit down. And I am training myself to stopping that kind of behavior, because it's not that I have anything against aging. I'm happy to age. I'm happy to get older and older and older and older and wiser and wiser and wiser and wiser and stronger and more handsome and more vital and more sexual, all of it. That idea that as you get to a certain age, sex goes away, who made that up? There are some Greek guys that have babies into their 90s. I know women stop after a while, and good for you, you should. But you know, why? And sex is a big part of what we should be talking about tonight. You know? Now, here's the thing. I had this discussion once recently with somebody, and they were like, you know, James, not everybody likes sex. And I was like, what? You're kidding me. And she was like, no, seriously. She said, I'd have never enjoyed it my whole life. And she said, don't tell me I haven't met the right person. She said, because trust me, I've tried it a lot and I just don't like it. And I've thought about that. And I thought, you know what? You're right. I have to stop thinking that everybody is like me, that thinks we want to be just Randy until the last moment of our life. But here's the thing. If you think it's because you're getting old, that's the problem. Not your tastes, not your personal preferences. So, okay. So I have asked Joe Jordon to talk to us tonight about, I believe she is probably the oldest one in the room. Is there anybody in the room tonight who is older than 94? Okay, good. I mean, good for you, but it doesn't really matter, does it? Well, then Josephine is our senior. Joe, you can go ahead and unmute. So Josephine is our senior, and I asked her to just give a little talk from this perspective. What do you want us to know now that we might not know now because we're not where you are now? Did you get that? So what do you want us to know now that we don't know now because we're not there now? And just listen to whatever comes up. Now, if you are looking at your screen gallery, I would suggest that you move it to speaker so that you can really just see Joe as she talks. And if you have questions or anything, you'll ask questions after she speaks, and I will interact with her if I need to. Okay, Josephine, yes, take it away.
Well, your choice of music was fabulous. Good evening, everybody. And thank you, Dr. Mellon, for giving me the chance to talk to my fellow thinkers.
Absolutely. Joe, can you back up a little bit so that you're we see your whole face?
You know. You go.
That's good. Your camera's up. There you go. Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. Don't move. Tonight, our discussion is aging in a world of ageism ethics. I don't know what that means, so I'll talk about something I do know, and that is getting old. And don't cringe, because it really isn't as bad as everybody makes it out to be. Aging is only the fact that you've been alive long enough to experience more events and things. That's it. That's a good thing. And I know I have, for sure. Let me share with you how I look at life today, a little about who I am and what goes on in my 94-year-old mind, okay? I know I'm partially reading this, and I want you to know that, because what goes on in my mind, I don't always follow the thought. Sometimes I deviate, and I don't want Dr. James to cut me off before I'm finished, so I have to stay within a frame, okay? I was born in 1928. I've lived through the Great Depression, World War II, the Vietnamese War, COVID, 25 years of AA, lupus, cancer, yada, 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 okay? I've seen upheavals on our planet, in and on, and nothing changes. Life goes on. I've been a rebel. Yeah, believe it or not, I still am in spots. Not too much to rebel against when you're pushing 100, but I know why now, because you realize that it doesn't really matter. Life's gonna do its thing anyway. So I have lived a miraculous life, and I've seen a lot of it. I was a surprise baby to my parents, who were already in their middle age when I came along, and who already had a 10-year-old daughter. Because my sister was more mature, they assumed I knew more about what I was doing. I think I was a good bluffer. So I grew up in a fantasy world of my own mind, which I consider the beginning of visualization for me. It's been a lifelong practice. I think of visualization as the observing the quantum physics speaks of. I use visualization a lot. I've had many, many miraculous, and I know you don't like the word miracle, Dr. James, but I consider them to be miracles. They're not happenstance. Is that a word? I don't know. Anyway, life is awareness, and awareness requires a thought process. Quantum physics tells us wherever thought goes, a chemical follows, and that chemical starts the process of manifestation, is activating the infinite possibilities. And that's why we have to watch our thoughts as carefully, because that little chemical that follows our thoughts is always ready to spring into action. That's a powerful tool to be aware of. Curiosity, imagination, and expectation is what's kept me here. I'm always expecting something good to happen. Duh. I know that sounds Pollyanna-ish, but that's a fact. It's almost a thought I waken up to every day. I won't even say a thought, it's a feeling I waken to every day. And despite the fact, as many of you may have noticed, that I don't walk very well, I am in perfect health. My body knows what to do, and I trust it to do it. My mind is in pretty good shape. I know I have lupus, but I've had it since I was a child. And although it comes back to bite me once in a while, I don't give it much space in my thought. Another reason I think I've been around for so long, and people laugh at me, I talk to my body constantly. It talks to me. I tell it, it's amazing and fantastic. I didn't always know that, but I do now. And even though I have to remind it once in a while, it forgets. I'm exactly where I'm supposed to be, with exactly the people I'm supposed to be here with. People who understand that although my thoughts are sometimes a bit scattered, or I forget a name, it's because, as Amy Shapiro said this morning, we are sometimes here and sometimes not. So I'm so grateful that love is at the center of my life. I have gratitude about my body, my mind. I'm super excited about quantum physics. And though I don't pretend to know the chemical or mathematical complexities, I don't care. I understand the basics and look forward to what more will be revealed. I want to stay alive for that. And the reason I'm telling you all this is because it makes me feel good to remember that we can have whatever life we visualize and desire through our thought. I really don't mind being not old, but chronologically advantaged. And we have a precious gift: our mind, our imagination, our curiosity. So anyway, I'm not through living. There's always more to experience. And people, for the most part, are really sweet to old people. You know what I thought when I saw that picture of that old guy? I wanted to hug him. That was my first thought. And in closing, I want to tell you I have a beautiful, supportive family. My son lives in Northern California. My daughter lives in Laurel Canyon. And my adoptive family lives a few blocks away on Bluebell. And I want to go this life to go on until it doesn't. Enough about me and my thoughts. I'd like to hear yours. But I'll leave you with a quote from a dear old friend of mine, Henry Miller, long ago departed. The aim of life is to live, and to live means to be aware, joyously, drunkenly, serenely, divinely aware. Thank you for listening.
That was beautiful, Joe. You made me cry.
Oh, good. Thank you.
What did you say? What was the phrase you used? I should have written it down. I'm not older, I am what?
Chronologically advantaged.
I love that. We're all chronologically advantaged.
Yeah.
Who wants to use that from now on, Sibylla, right? I am chronologically advantaged. Did you just make that up?
No, I read it years ago. I've been using it for years.
Oh, well, it's yours now. That was great. Just great. Well, you know what I like that you said that I want to bring up? I keep telling Joe I can't wait to be the person that gets to celebrate her 100th birthday. And for a long time, she'd be like, when she was in her late 80s or right as she was turning 90, she goes, oh, I don't want to be here when I'm 100. No. But it's changing. You heard her tonight. She's now talking about more to do, more life, more, why she's here. And I love hearing that, because I will be there when we celebrate your 100th, and you are going to be just as vibrant, just as alive, just as awake, just as aware, just as ornery as you have been the whole time I've known you.
Well, I'll still be pushing around my little push cart, my little scooter.
Your little scooter that takes nothing to get into a back seat of a car. It's perfect. So questions. Who has some questions for Joe? If you, you raise your hand. We'll start with Ginny. Ginny, and what I do is I go ahead and give you permission to unmute. Go ahead, Ginny.
There it goes. Hi. First of all, Dr. James, I have to tell you something that keeps me from groaning when I get up or sit down, and you'll appreciate this. Sophia Loren was asked many years ago how she remains so youthful, and she says, "I don't make a noise when I get up from a table." So now I think Sophia Loren, so I'm offering you that tip.
Oh, I love that it was one of Sophia Loren. You know what another one is? Catherine Deneuve says, when you have to choose between your ass and your face, choose your face. And what she means is gain a little weight. It's okay. Your face looks healthier.
Ah, how fun. So that's what I just think Sophia Loren, and then I don't grow. Anyway, Joe, I wanted to jump right in because yes, the chronically advantaged, I wrote it down, but just a couple of questions for you, because like Dr. James, I come from the entertainment industry where ageism starts in your 40s and even worse for women. So as a producer and a writer, you know, it's been a long time since I was 40. But what I wanted to ask you is, are you living on your own?
Yes, I am.
That is very inspiring because I went back to Chicago to help my mom, who my siblings wanted to move her into assisted living, and she wanted to stay in her own home, and I made that happen until she was 90. But that's what you see behind me is my affordable living community for seniors and pets. And what I'm trying to do is support seniors and being able to live independently, but surrounded by like-minded people, and most importantly, our pets. I saw Lori holding her dog a minute ago. So that's what my dream is and what keeps me going. But I just want to tell you, you're my new role model. And as I'm approaching a birthday next month, I'm going to say, I'm chronologically advantaged. So yeah. That's the takeaway from this. So thank you very much for being with us tonight. And Dr. James, thank you for doing this. I love it.
Oh,
that.
Absolutely. Thanks, Ginny.
Thank you.
Okay, who else has something for Josephine? Yes, Sharon. Hit it. Go ahead and unmute.
Yeah.
There, you got it.
First of all, very inspirational. I'm 81, and one of my missions, and you're such an example, is to be a standard for seniors who have bought into the aging matrix. And the aging matrix is all of these things set up by the medical journals of what happens to the body 50, 60, 70. So if you're 70 or 80, they turn, this is just a joke, but they turn to page 80 and you have, this is what is going on. And so these doctors in the white coats become the authority. But Deepak Chopra says, the body is in your consciousness.
Yes, yes, yes.
The body is in your consciousness. And so I, as a young girl, when I saw people walking with walkers and whatnot, I said, no, I'm not doing that. I don't choosing that. And I'm very excited to be 81. I just turned 81. I'm very up and around, and I can dance, and I can what all that I want to do. And it's exciting to see what in our consciousness, how we will create our own bodies going forward, how we will allow, which is a natural process for the body to rejuvenate itself. Every single organ can rejuvenate itself. So those are some comments that I have right now.
Thank you, Sharon. That was great. I want to point out something that she just said. As you age, your body rejuvenates itself. not as you age, your body gets less and less vital. No, that doesn't change. When you age, your body does not stop rejuvenating. It still acts perfectly. In fact, the thought that we have these aging bodies is kind of bizarre because every 7 years we have an entirely new set of genes. But one of the things that Bruce Lipton talks about in the biology of belief, he talks about the fact that, yes, every 7 years you have a whole new system of genes, a brand new revitalized system that most people educate based on their conscious mind. So the mind takes these new genes and lets those genes know you're old, you're this, you're that. And you also said what your Deepak Chopra says, your body is in your mind. He doesn't mean that as a nice slogan and it's a nice, your mind creates your body. No, he means your physical body is actually in your mind, is in your consciousness. So we're just buying into a lot of crap that we don't need to buy into. Thor?
Joe, I wanted to ask you, yesterday we saw some little slice of your career as a performer. And I'm curious, as you've moved through the various chapters of your life, did you ever think of yourself as, I'm retired from one thing, I'm moving to another? Or what was your mindset as you've moved through the various things you've done in life?
There really has never been a mindset about anything. I just sort of live life as it comes. As a matter of fact, it's really funny because I was thinking when I remember trying to think of a stage name when I first was getting an agent. And I thought Joe Summers, that's a good name, I think, so I used that for a while. Anyway, the thing is, it didn't seem to be that important to me. I just went through life and had some good luck. And I've never really thought about it. I've enjoyed every section of it, and there's been various parts of it, and I think I've been fortunate as hell. Really have.
Well, not to quote Mae West, but I'm going to. Luck had nothing to do with it. You are equal to everything that is brought into your experience throughout your whole life. And I love Thor's question because I want to talk about the idea of retirement, because you are not retired. You've never been retired. Although Joe is one of the first persons that said to me, I forget when she said it, she was in a class one night and she said something about, well, what about people like me that are living on a fixed income? And I looked at her, do you remember what I said? I said, well, who fixed it? And Joe was like, well, I mean, yeah. And she just waited a minute and she went, oh, I guess I did. I said, you fixed it, unfix it. Fix it into something else. And the funny thing about Joe is she never stopped working. I think you start working even more after that when you decided to, like, I'm done. I'm just going to start working again. She just shot an episode of This Is Us. She had one of the last episodes of one of the most, profound series, successful series. And, they just call her. They just called her recently and asked her if she wanted to do a movie in, what was it, Canada?
Yeah.
And she was like, no, not going to Canada. But she gets to say that. She's just like, no, I can't. Most actors at any age are like, wherever, Canada, India, wherever you want me to go, I'll go act. Joe's like, nah, I'll stay here. Something will come along I'd rather do. So I love that you asked that. She is not retired. You don't consider yourself retired, do you, Joe?
Not a way.
No, not at all. So, okay, somebody else had their hand up. Bonnie, was it you? Go ahead, Bonnie.
Okay. First of all, yes, I was just going to say, I remember last year, Joe is going, oh, I've got this, This Is Us. And, and she's talking and it's like, yeah, she's working all the time. It doesn't matter. And, but I want to say one thing, and I don't think this has happened to Joe. The thing about ageism and has driven me crazy from the get-go is I hear people, younger people, talking to older people and saying, oh, you have such lovely pearls. Isn't that cute? Drives me crazy. It's like all of a sudden.
You have such lovely pearls?
Yes. I mean, you know, a necklace or,
And a pearl necklace. I get it.
Yes. And it drives me crazy that they're treating them like some little kid that they have to. And this happens a lot. I swear to God, I see this happen all the time. And, you know, as a matter of fact, Patrick's mother, when we were all at a party, someone came up and said, oh, your earrings are so cute, honey. How do you get them that lovely? I saw red. I mean, that is, to me, that is a slap in the face. And that happens so much in this country, especially with older people. Instead of being the elders and looking up to them and with respect and saying, wow, you know, you've got some experience behind you, share it.
It
drives me crazy.
And I'm trying to remember who just said this. Someone just shared this with me. Oh God, I can't remember. If you're on here, tell me it's you. Somebody just said to me that they now know, maybe it was you, Joe. I think it was you, Joe, that people look at Joe and they go, it is you, Joe. You said it to me driving. They look at her and they go, hi, how are you doing?
Yes.
And Joe said, you know what I do now? I look at them and I go, I'm good. How are you?
Thank you. And I have to share one other story. Quite a few years ago, there's a New Year's party that a lot of science mind people go to on New Year's Day. And most of them are aging actors and elders and so forth. And so I've gone, and one day, and the place was crowded. And so one New Year's Day, I'm there, and I mean, it's packed. And I walk by this woman, kind of standing there, you know, the piano's playing. And she's saying, yes, she said, someone said, so you just had your 100th birthday? And she said, oh, yes, yes. She said, actually in December. And she's going, and, you know, we went dancing and so forth. This was Connie Sawyer. She was an actress. And Connie, I mean, I talked to her afterwards. She danced there at the party, and she was, you know, like this. This next year came, she came to the party. She was 101. We talked, and we talked about, you know, various things. At 102, she was there. And she was saying when she was 102, she had seen Angela Lansbury. And she said, I just went down to, you know, the thing, and I saw Angela Lansbury. She said, my God, what a performer, you know. And she's going on, absolutely. At 103, she made an excuse, the fact that she had to use a cane. She said her daughter made it. She didn't come to the 104th, and on the 105th, because it was cold outside. So 105th, she passed after she had her 105th, and that was Connie Sawyer.
Yeah, I knew Connie Sawyer.
Yes, I mean, she was electric.
So what's your point?
My point is that the age doesn't matter.
Okay, so that is the point. That's the point tonight. Age doesn't matter, unless it does.
Yeah, I mean,
age only matters if it matters to you. I have to move on, Bonnie, because I have other people's hands up. Great, thank you for sharing that, and I loved Connie Sullivan. Sharon Kelly, Reverend Doctor, you know your camera's not on.
I know, my camera's not working, I apologize, but I'm here, and Joe, I love you so much, and you know, we've been talking for a long time about getting together and talking about the seasons of life and getting older, and as you know, I just passed my 80th birthday, and you know, I don't feel any different than I always did. I'm still me, and I know you're still you, and we just have to just stand in that knowing who we still are. I mean, who we are, and it's not, this race consciousness doesn't have to be in our consciousness, and we don't have to accept it as something that we have to endure. I love to dance. I love to sing. I love to be with friends, and I know you do too. And you just, are inspiration to me, and I still want to get together and have a private conversation.
Yes.
Life.
Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Sharon.
I really love you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon.
Absolutely. So I want to talk about a little something that was said, and I don't remember who said it. I think it was Jenny Weissman. Is there ageism in the entertainment field? Oh, you bet your ass there is. There is. And what do you do about it? Well, frankly, I don't believe there's anything to do about it other than to, as I said in my quote this morning, don't let what matters most in your life be at the mercy of what matters least. Those that have that kind of prejudice, highest and furthest, that's it. Don't buy into it. And certainly don't react to it. You cannot live from primal first thought. You cannot live from the divine ideal and the Christ consciousness and the highest level of knowing if you're willing to drop down to the level of the relative bigotry, the relative racism, the relative ageism. Yeah, it is there. And I suggest you don't pretend it's not, so that you don't just live in this world of fantasy, but you see it. There is ageism. And you're right. I saw an article, I saw a talk show with Meryl Streep, and they asked her how she avoided ageism in her career. And she looked, who was she talking to? I think it was Larry King. No, it wasn't Larry King, somebody more elegant. Anyway, she looked right at the person and she said, "Why would you think that I have not encountered ageism?" She said, "You know, most people think whatever role I want, I just go and take it." She said, and she mentioned a couple of roles, I wish I could think of them. She said, "Do you know how many roles I wanted that went to someone else because they thought I was too old or not pretty enough?" I remember the person saying, "Really? So you've encountered?" She goes, "Yes." And I think she was like in her early 60s when she had this conversation. She said, I don't get offered any of those roles that I used to get offered, even though I could conceivably still play them. She said, but they know how old I am. Everyone knows how old I am. She's like, everybody knows when I graduated from Yale. You can put two and two together. You know how old I am. So you don't give me those roles. She said, so it happens. She said, however, for every role that someone has a prejudice against my age, there's 10 more that I get to choose from. She said, so I don't put my focus on the ones that don't want me. She said, who would want to spend their life just paying attention to the people that don't want to be with us? I mean, she's teaching science of mind herself in all of this, but that's the case, you know? Okay, yes, Karen Needle. Then I'll go to you, Jennifer. Go ahead, Karen, you have to,
I recently had an experience a couple weeks ago about prescriptions. I have a skin condition called vitiligo. I've been waiting for 25 years for FDA to approve something because there's been no cure for it. And they recently came up with a cream, finally FDA approved, went to the dermatologist, got a prescription. I'm so excited thinking he's telling me it's going to be a $20 copay. Turns out my copay is $1,200.
Ooh.
And I said, what are you talking about, $1,200? They said, well, it's regularly $2,500. And I'm like, I said, but I was also told there were coupons. He went, oh, yes, there are coupons, but not for you. And I'm like, well, excuse me, what do you mean, but not for me? He said, well, you're over 65.
Really?
That
seems kind of backwards.
Well, yeah. But they won't work with Medicare. They won't. If I was on Medi-Cal, I could get it. If I was 64, I could get it, but not at 65 or over.
Okay, so where do you go with that? Consciously.
No.
I'm just wondering because here's the thing, folks. Tonight's just not just about showing all the ageism in the world. It's really more about what do we do with it? How do we react to it?
Well,
so what did you do?
What I did do is I called the doctor's office. They called an advocate. The advocate called me and they said, if you don't have enough money, let us know, send us your things, you know, your estimates, and we can at least give you two tubes. And I told them how much I have coming in. They said, oh, you don't qualify because you don't have enough. So it's like,
and so what are you going to do?
I'm going to live without it, I guess. I don't know. I mean, and not be worried about it. I have lived without it for this long. I don't, any other ideas?
Sharon, go ahead, Sharon. Let me unmute you. To mute you back up, Karen. Sharon, go ahead. You have to unmute.
Okay. Alternatives. There are so many alternative creams out of Australia and New Zealand. The doctors don't know all of it. You just got to do a little homework on finding something yourself that you don't need coupons and you could afford it.
I hear what you're saying, and I'm gonna put it in a more quantum sense, Sharon.
Please do. Yeah.
Yes. I don't believe we ever, 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 ever need to settle for the answer, I'll do without it, at all. That there is some other way. But the other way is not about driving yourself crazy trying to find the other way or fighting against what you perceive as ageism. But the other way is to get very quiet, very centered within yourself, and there will be another way. For instance, we did a remodel of our house about 8 years ago now. And I approved a certain amount of money for our remodel, and because I knew what I had for the remodel. And without throwing my husband under the bus, he really does live from the concept that prosperity is his and ours, and there is always enough. And so we went probably maybe $200,000 over the budget we had planned. And I was paying attention to the numbers as they came in. And all of a sudden I was like, are you aware that there's $200,000 more than we're? He goes, yeah, I'm sure you'll figure it out. And I just got quiet. I got quiet and dealt with my own self. And I went, there is an answer. There is an answer. I know that my prosperity is unbounded. And all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, I was on the computer doing something, and a little thing popped up for this new second mortgage on your house, a loan that you could take. And I went in, I looked at it, and I went, oh, this all makes great sense. And I went in, I was approved within 24 hours, and the whole $250,000 came back. And the better answer was, it was based on your house. As your house gets more, as is worth more, you have to keep the mortgage for 3 years, you pay nothing on it. And at the end of the 3 years, whatever, if you want to pay it off, whatever your house is worth, more, like if it went up by $400,000, they would actually get 33% of that, whatever it went up by, as well as paying back the loan. And I was like, I can do that. Well, who would have known that the COVID would hit and the reset, you know, all the so when it came time to pay it back, I actually didn't owe anything extra except what we had. The mortgages were down to nothing. We refinanced to 2.4% from 6% and paid the whole thing off. All of it unfolded perfectly, but it came from, and I know this, it came from me being absolutely clear that I am not boxed in. There's no for an answer, and that the answer will always unfold. So that's what I'm going to know for you, Karen. Someone's already written on here, Canadian Pharmacy. You know, just check to see if there's something out there just like it. Write to the company itself and say, hey, whatever, it's there. It's going to be, just know, it's going to unfold perfectly. Okay. Other hand, yes, Sherry Verson. Sherry Verson at 71. 75. Wow, I missed a few birthdays.
You did. I just had one.
Okay. 75. Wow, we should be doing something big for 75.
7.5 years apart, I think. Because okay. You're in September, I'm in September. Okay.
Oh, okay.
What I wanted to say is I'm doing some home health aid work right now. And I work with three fantastic, beautiful women that I look after. And but it's so clear to me the difference in their thinking and their beliefs, because you know, one particular woman, she doesn't want to have people see her because of her ailments and things like that, and she refuses to walk with her cane so she won't go outside. And you know, and then I have another woman who just embraces it all. And she has so much vitality and energy, and, you know, her spirit is so strong, but it really is so clearly what we're believing about ourselves and how we're, you know, seeing ourselves. And it's been very insightful. I'm grateful to have the experience. Yeah.
Oh, that's beautiful, Sherry. That's great. And what a great person to have for you. Yes, Jennifer. Sorry, I keep missing you. Go ahead, Jennifer. By the way, everybody, for those of you that watched the telethon, and by the way as well, those of you who have not watched the telethon, I want to announce this tonight. We will be sending out an e-blast to everyone with the link to the telethon.
Because
Stan Galperson has stepped up and has promised $2,500 if it's matched to get us to our $12,000 goal. I invite you to watch the telethon and then make a donation. We have to just raise another $2,500, and then he kicks in another $2,500, and we've made our $12,000 mark. So there you go. You'll hear more about that. But this is Jennifer, who, how many people did see the telethon? Raise your hand. So a lot of you still have something to see. So this, Sybilla, is Jennifer from the Johnny Carson Show. And you'll know it as soon as she speaks. Go ahead, Jennifer.
Just a couple of things to say and then a question. I think like everybody here, Joe, I am so madly in love with you. Mm-hmm. You are such a light. From the first class I ever took, you shine. There is just something so vibrant and alive and beautiful about your spirit. Oh. And you're obviously a very beautiful woman, but your light just shines. And it's so attractive. I just want you to know that.
And
it's like you're the personification of something I've always believed, that we're always the same age inside. And that's what, I mean, I don't feel any different than I did when I was young and vital and in my appearance and in my strengths and stuff like that. But my question to you is this. The one thing that I struggle with a little bit, you know, not really recognizing myself in the mirror and having that longing for that time of our blossom, that time when we were, you know, when life was just in unfolding exactly the way we hoped and wanted it to be. And now it still is as joyful and delicious as it's always been. But there's, I don't know, I'm speaking for myself. There is that longing for that. And how do you get past that longing?
We don't.
Did you say we don't? Joe?
Pardon?
What did you just say?
We don't get past it, I don't think. It's something that we remember with happiness. I like to remember a lot of things.
Yeah, me too.
So I don't want to get over it. I like to look back and think, and it makes me happy.
Mm-hmm. Like that picture of you pole dancing.
Yeah, the wrong one. Yeah.
There's a great picture of her. I think we showed it yesterday at the telethon, of her on a pole with that gorgeous leg out and that little tight number she was wearing. And so do you ever look at that and think, oh, I wish I could do that again. I wish I could look like that again.
No, I hated every second of it. I really did. I remember coming down one New Year's Eve, I think it was, and I had to work, coming down that pole and just crying. And I had to stop in the middle and show the leg and what have you. Yeah, no, I hated that.
Didn't well, like there- it. And there you go. But I will tell you, Jennifer.
I won't remember.
but I mean, how many of you, be honest, how many of you look back in an old picture of yourself and wish you could still look like that?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I do that.
Okay, well, I can't think of what Jennifer's talking about. Not recognize yourself in the mirror. And I have to tell you, I said this yesterday at the telethon. I was pulling up a picture of Kevin and I, and I actually feel like I look very much like I looked when I was younger. I really do. I don't feel like I look that much older at all. And I pulled up the picture of Kevin and I swiped to the left to see if I had two of them, and I didn't. And it was a picture of me from the other day with Eric Overholzer. And I was like, holy God. Because I had just looked at my younger self, and then I went back to the younger self, and then I pulled them both up next to each other, and I went, okay, yeah, you have aged. You've aged. But you know what I also did? I went, you have aged, and you've aged really well. Are you okay with that? Are you okay aging well? And my answer is, yeah. Do I want to look like that again? I don't need to look like that again. My son looks exactly like that. So if I really want to see it, I just have to call him up and have him come over, and I'll be like, oh, there I am. Yeah. Karen Bebb, who knew me when I was that young 25-year-old.
Oh boy, did I know him. Well, that's another story. Anyway, yes. My acting was so stressed you out. Did you watch my monologue and not be able
I did. I couldn't get it to work. I couldn't get it off my computer. Yes, it was very, very dark though. Karen did a monologue for the telethon, and I got it, but I couldn't actually move it over. But thank God, because it was all about like pedophilia, and it was so depressing. I was like, oh my God, this will really break in the money.
Because what you said, you're going to put Susan or somebody singing after me. But anyway,
even Susan couldn't have redeemed that.
Well, the thing is that there's all those little sexy roles that you get to play young, and the skinny little figure that you had and the sizes that I fit into that I had dysmorphia about. I'm like, I'm really this size? I'd get to a shoot and they'd say, yeah, this is for you. I'm like, oh, I don't fit in that. And I did fit in it. Is that I spent all those years disliking me, never being exactly what I wanted to be, trying so hard. Every time you get on the scale, I was still worried about it, but I had just, I didn't really know what I looked like, I guess, but I'm more comfortable now. I'm older. I don't like my neck. I don't like my, but I love myself in my body more. I'm so comfortable in my body. And part of it is that you don't get the googly-eyed at. Like, I can just be myself. Sometimes I'll be talking to somebody and I'll say, oh okay, thanks, honey. And then if they look at me funny, I go, I'm
packing. Oh, we're losing you. You're going in and out. Is everybody seeing that?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's your connection, Karen.
Jennifer, no. your voice is so cute, and you're
now you're muted. Karen, I'm going to move on only because we're missing you, but I think you were talking about Jennifer. I want to tell you something funny, Jennifer. In the room, everybody in the room was laughing hysterically. It's such a great interview, and it was nice because it was so sexist. It was so misogynistic, right? And it's so not what we would do today, nor could Johnny Carson ever get away with that today in this world. And it was funny because of that. But what I saw was somebody sitting there who knew exactly what she was doing.
Yes.
Who was on top of it all. And you actually, especially when you told them your IQ, you had the whole thing. But in the room when it was over, Tiffany was like, yeah, she has great breasts. She has an amazing, but who has a waist that small? All of them were like, she's got like a, right? Didn't you say that, Tiffany? Yeah. Tiffany was like, whose waist is that tiny? Yeah, it was a great. Thank you for letting us all share in that. Susan Edwards Martin. Susan?
Hi. Let me lower the hand thing because it puts me in a weird spot. I don't know where I am now. Anyway, thank you, James, for having this tonight. Thank you for the telethon yesterday. That was like so special and so much fun. Hey, why don't we do a show? Okay. And all of a sudden we're doing a show like 3 days later. It was wonderful. I love that. And Joe, you are just so delicious. I just so admire you. You so inspire me. Thank you. Thank you. And Jennifer, to talk about what you said, the getting the aging thing, I do look my other photos of me and stuff. But I've kind of resolved that I'm embracing as I'm aging. I'm kind of digging it because I know so much more and I have such a better understanding of the truth of who I am. So when I show up someplace, it's not my ego showing up and my insecure little self. Everyone's got to love me. I just feel so solid. I love who I've become, you know, so I'm fine. I didn't like my eyes. They were getting too heavy. So I did take care of them during COVID. So they made me look a little younger, but that's the only thing I've really done. But another question that Peter actually had, and he wanted me to ask you, when you talked about the body renews itself every 7 years. So when do you know what year you're in? I know the earth replenishes. I know the earth replenishes every 7 years. You know, and according to the Bible, every 7 years, you know, 6th year, you got to stop plowing and allow it. So what happens with the body? How do you know?
I don't know. That's a good question. Let's just always assume. Maybe we should always assume we're in year one and talk to our bodies from that year one consciousness. Oh, that's a great question. Tell Peter thank you.
Thank you. He's over there in the dark. So.
Okay. Thank you, Peter. Well, good. Your room's dark.
You're very welcome, James.
Well, sometimes, Peter, your room's not dark when you walk out of the bathroom in your little shorts. While we're doing spirit breath and her beautiful husband walks by, almost like Karen Oxrider's husband, when he walked by and he wasn't even wearing shorts. Because he didn't realize Mike's camera was on. We get a lot of eye candy with a lot of our productions. So it's 5:56. I have time for one more question before I close us.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, Susan. Anybody else have another question before?
Okay. I just want to say thank you to everyone. Mwah. I love you all.
Joe, thank you for being here and thank you for taking the time. Hold on, McKay. Hey, McKay.
Hi, Dr. James. How are you?
I'm good. So good to see you.
Yes. Are you going to be doing these meetings again?
Yeah, we do Let's Talk once a month.
Well, I meant specifically on ageism.
Well, I don't know what the next theme is going to be, but this tonight was about ageism. But yeah, I don't know if we'll do it again, but you can always ask a question next time as well. Who knows what the next one's about? My next one might be about Tap Dancers Anonymous.
Okay.
Thank you for asking, though. So, to close us out, Peter, did you have your hand up? Go ahead, Peter. Hold on.
Am I good?
Yeah, you're good. You're great.
I want to reveal that episode for those of you who don't know. There is a group within our center called the Spiritual Warriors. They're a group of elderly gentlemen who are slowly adapting to this teaching. Dr. James came to one of our meetings in drag. He came a very butch guy he looked kind of like a homeless dude. And most of our guys look kind of homeless when they come Saturday morning. But it's a very touching group. And so one of the advantages of being an aging male is this teaching hasn't reached very many older males. And they're out there at sea alone. And so it gives you a wonderful opportunity to reconnect, because that's who we older folks, a lot of the reconnections are. There's a lot of good work to be done out there, and it's very rewarding. Thanks, Dr. James.
My God, thank you, Peter. Thank you. Yes, I was doing gardening out back, and I had a baseball cap on and a really dirty t-shirt and like holes in my jeans. And I was like, oh, I told the guys I'd show. Oh, I'll just get in the car and go. So I walked in. It had already started. I sat down and they're all sharing. And then all of a sudden somebody went, would the new guy like to introduce himself? And I was like, they didn't even know it was me. And Stan Galperson went, it's Dr. James. And the guys were like, whoa. I was like, God, am I that feminine? I mean, really? And they said yes. So, but it was a great meeting. And I never went back because I always feel like it's not that they don't want me there, but that like, I don't want to invade a space as the spiritual director. But I think I'm going to change that concept, Peter, because what you just said really, really touched me. And you're right. We have great needs in our world. for this teaching and this understanding. So I want to close by just saying that the topic of ageism and, you know, the ageist ethics, we have bought into a concept of what aging is. And the ethics around it has shifted from treating our aged people, which I am one, with the reverence and the respect and to really honor and to benefit from what has come from, as Joe said, living so many experiences of life. I mean, she went all the way back to, you know, the Great Depression, the World Wars, Vietnam, pandemic, you know, all the things that have gone on in our lifetime. And it's only going to change if every single one of you and me change it for ourselves. It doesn't mean to go fight it. It means we are going to change it. We are going to go out in the world, go travel, meet people, do the things we're here to do, be the people we're here to be, as David Bowie said, finally realizing all the capabilities I have and that nothing is off the table. Nothing should be off the table. If I want to go do Singing in the Rain again, probably at some, you know, retirement home, then I should be able to go play Don Lockwood and dance my ass off. Seriously. And if I need oxygen, Marcy and Al will have oxygen for me in each wing waiting for me to get off the stage. So whatever it takes. So that's why I wanted to talk about this tonight with a woman who really does live life to the fullest, shows you her vulnerabilities, tells you when she's sad, tells you when something's bothering her, and always, always, always comes back around to this teaching, which is that right where I am, God is, because it's who I am and it's what I am. So thank you all for being here this evening. Thank you, Josephine, for gracing us. And thank you all for your comments, for your consciousness. Have a beautiful, beautiful rest of your night. And I will see some of you, a lot of you, at tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. in Mental Muscle. Namaste.